doesn't have a life, it's not interesting, whether it's well catalogued or not. So that's really what sort of like was my my beginnings with you. And so we had to shut down a database in the end, and make sure the data was safe. So that's like a summary of where it came from.
Then the curatorial journey. So the things that you find more interesting. And can you just say a little bit about, I suppose, what you actually inherited in terms of what was there, particularly in the Deakin Archive?
So the Deakin Archive is the most record heavy part of James Moore's collection in that, because Deakin was a photographer, there are 12 shots on a roll and he took hundreds and hundreds of rolls. We've got thousands of image records of negatives, so we've spent a long time digitizing them, and then again 3 years later checking that we digitized everything, because as we learned we realized that we didn't really know what we were doing back then, so we did it all again. I suppose that sounds familiar. So the term curator is interesting, because you put curator in the pack, and on here I put administrator and archivist. So I was heartened to hear earlier, I think the first speaker saying, you know, that archivists tend to have loads of different jobs. So I was like, oh God, yeah, that's me. None of them trained in, none of them especially skilled in, but you have to pick up bits and bobs. And I suppose over the 10 years really that I've been doing it, I've moved towards wanting to research and be given the time to research exactly what it is that we think that we've got, and then use that, the discoveries of the things that you've got, or the theories of the things you've got, to try and tell stories through it, so that at least you can make the hundreds and hundreds of images that we had that were just untitled. We didn't know who they were, where they were, what they were of, why they were taken, who commissioned them or not. We just had hundreds of negatives. So it was just really a process of getting into it, and I was lucky that I've got the sort of brain and a connection to Deakin, I suppose, that I got into trying to find out what it is that the photographs represent, when they were taken, who the people are in them, and had a long and winding path through that.
So it's just really interesting, in terms of Art 360, the fundamental trajectory of Art 360 is thinking about DAX, you know, by artists, for artists, a sense of thinking about legacies. It also implies a sense that if you're thinking about your legacy in your lifetime, then you can either unpick some of the challenges of a future generation might have in your relationship with their work if they're trying to understand it. And one of the most obvious, you know, challenges in that sense is this question of what is this stuff? Mm. You know, fundamentally, you know, how do you differentiate what materials are? Mm. And for me, with the Deakin Archive, as you're saying, what's most challenging there is that there's a loose sense, this is stuff by John Deakin, we understood he hang out in the colony rooms, we understood, you know, he had a career as a photographer, and then what more do we know?
Yeah.
So can you say a little bit then, what methodologies have you used to identify those materials? So I should say,
the archive, what we call the archive, is material that was found under Deakin's bed. I say found, it's another sort of subjective opinion. By his friend called Bruce Bernard, who, on hearing of his death, apparently forced his way into the flat and pulled out all the stuff from under the bed, and then over a period of 15 years went through, catalogued it from his own memory of knowing Deakin well and knowing the times and some of the people. So he would have narrated, or somebody would have annotated what he was saying out loud, because we have a lot of sound-alike words for people's names that don't necessarily sort of come anywhere near to what I would eventually find was their real name, but you acquire an ear for the way they got it wrong, and it's my understanding that it was a person that without an ear for European sounding names, particularly an Australian person who hasn't built up that kind of cultural awareness of every now and then hearing or talking to Europeans perhaps more regularly. So I tuned myself into being able to kind of like fossick out names. Some of them took me ages, and some of them came like a bolt. And I'm pleased that a lot of the kind of untitled people I've managed to kind of find. I took that as my initial challenge. But the stories of Deakin, if they are told, are the stories because of his associations with Francis Bacon on the one hand, because he took photographs that Bacon painted from, and on the other hand, his career at Vogue magazine, a pretty disastrous career because he was an alcoholic, and one of the stories that that's kind of entrenched about him is that he wasn't a particularly likable person. And I took that as a kind of a challenge to deconstruct where that unlikability might reside, because as a queer man in a time, Deacon I'm talking about, although I'm a queer man myself, but I took that ability to kind of identify that outsiderness as an imposition on him, and that his apparent humour might be read as bitchiness, depending on how far in or how far outside you are of a queer community or an awareness of a queer community. And I managed to find an obituary that hadn't been spotted in the Times for John Deacon, written by the writer Elizabeth Smart, who he was very close to, which I take as a credit to Deacon that he was close to her, and vice versa, where she said that Deacon claimed Bacon said that he was the funniest man in London. And I think that's just a really important sort of thing to consider, is that funniness can veer into unlikability depending on how close you are to the source of the camp. And so that sort of thing is his personality, his Deacon's personality, is the narrative of his personality is in control of whoever is telling it at the current time. And I see myself in the slot where people before me, for example, the writer Robin Muir is kind of like with the archivist at Vogue, and he curated the show that we had in 2014, and I worked closely with him, and his research is strongly connected to this narrative that Deacon was chaotic and unlikable, and I'm not saying it's wrong, it's just a reading that is his own and is particularly attractive because we all like the nasty, bitchy, funny man who's witty, and you know. But and then before that, well, there's the character Bruce Bernard, who's very important to the Deacon archive story because he found that or reclaimed the material. Again, as a straight man, his interpretation of Deacon's story will come as a reflection of his identity and the times. Yes, I feel like I've rattled on along there, and I don't know if I near to what you're asking.
And I think that fundamentally, yes, because you're going into this zone of exploration, which is a methodology which is trying to take a different route into the body of work, right. And in doing that, driving new narrative possibilities.
Yeah.
So in a classic sense, in terms of the archive and its access, it seems to me that one of the things you've been providing is a lot of in-depth research into particular images.
Yes.
And those images are then inspiring.
We should click to something.
Yeah, maybe we should
do
this.
Do I click on? Here we go.
Yeah. So this relationship to your archival role, again, what I'm particularly interested in is looking. You know, the question of images, when we see them in books, etc. When we see them in books, they obviously do have some kind of captioning. But your work is looking at an image and trying to imagine what that image.
I'm trying to keep talking about Deacon in a way that people will find useful or interesting and might use in whatever work that they're doing. Because once you have an exhibition, and you work for a collector, everything. I would imagine there's a tendency for everything just to go back in the cupboard, and then you wait 5 years for somebody else to come along with the right idea to get it all back out again. And I persuaded James that it was a shame to do that. I'll just talk about what's showing here, particularly as it's coming up to Lucian Freud there and his manner of talking to Bacon, is that there's a campness that I can read comes out of Bacon's movement there, which looking at the static images you wouldn't have done. So there, this is. And then you see Freud look wide-eyed at super wide-eyed. And so I spoke to his biographer, whose head's mad. You see it. Who's I can't remember his name. Sorry. Anyway, he's got a book coming out. Yeah, he's got a book coming out about Freud soon. And there's a Deacon image as the cover image. I spoke to him about this, that look. And he said that that was the only image that exists of this habit that Freud had of, once he'd said something particularly apposite or deep, he would look at you super wide-eyed in expectation that you would be stunned. And it was almost acting out your reaction. And people used to talk about this reaction that he would do, but there's never been a photograph of it. So if there's a famous image by Deakin, one of the most famous or well used is the Wheeler's Lunch one image. It's called Wheeler's Lunch after the restaurant that they're supposedly in, and lunch after the meal they're supposedly having. But Deakin took 36 shots, so I was able to sequence the best ones and try and find a way through putting them together, because our initial cataloguing strips of negatives all cut up, all properly put into holders, the original sequence of these negatives is lost. And as an example of our original cataloguing, that's a good example, is that our original cataloguing is really dependent on who's thinking about it at the time. We have no consistency of approach, and I'm aware of that, that in if whoever comes after me, I'm constantly thinking whenever I'm cataloguing, is how are they ever going to know where I've got this from? And so I just leave endless kind of text in the description boxes trying to say how I arrived at this.
But it's really, I suppose that's a really great example of thinking very creatively about the material in front of you and wondering what it can show you.
Yeah. And I was conscious of moving it from a static image into a moving image as well, and kind of like breaking the rules of photography. But it's just interesting enough that it got picked up. And I showed it to a few people, and eventually there's a foundation in Monaco called the Francis Bacon MB Art Foundation. And they were interested in it enough to commission me to do some research actually onto the circumstances of Wheeler's Lunch, the photograph called Wheeler's Lunch, where I discovered, and I spoke to some people close to Auerbach, who was able to say that it wasn't a lunch, they didn't eat anything, the champagne was unopened, it was actually a photo call at 10 o'clock in the morning, and all of them were really fed up at having to get there that early, but I think it suggests their closeness to Deakin, that they did it for him. And it was supposed to be an image for a magazine that didn't end up getting used in the magazine, and it passed into folklore as this kind of like clubby bohemian lunch that we all like to think that the School of London pages were always kind of like out roustabouting, but that the image doesn't represent that. So I was also conscious in that story, in that kind of research line, of taking something away from the aura of the image by bringing more truth to it. I was taking away its kind of like its romance, I suppose.
So another aspect of your work that you've told me about is this sense that there's one version of particularly Deakin. He's part of the comedy group, and it's kind of gay, it's drunk, it's X, Y, Z. But you've also managed to push that envelope, and can you explain a little bit about the, I suppose, the impetus to do that, why expand the envelope, and how have you achieved that?
Well,
and a little bit about what you found.
Okay, so Deakin worked at Vogue, so Vogue Archives have all the work that he made while he worked for them. Deakin took photographs that may or may have not been commissioned in part by Bacon, that ended up on Bacon's studio floor. So neither of that material, which is kind of like the material that people associate with Deakin, none of that material ended up in Deakin's own collection or his own store under his bed. The stuff that we've got relates to partly to the raw negatives of images that Bacon, the prints that Bacon print used to paint from, but a lot of it is Deakin's career right back from pre-war. And one of the stories, kind of like the impositions of Deakin's identity, is the Bruce Bernard called it the salvage of a photographer, which kind of suggests in some way that it was neglected or rescued from some sort of destruction. And of course he did remove it from Deakin's flat, but we don't know what would have happened if he hadn't removed it. But also the fact that this is material that wasn't necessarily, wasn't at all neglected in the manner of its keeping, in that Deakin was had periods of homelessness, was a chronic alcoholic, moved so many times, his life was interrupted by the war, but he still managed to maintain this material under his bed all that time. time. So I was able to kind of like suggest there's another way of thinking about this material, that it's not just, you know, detritus, it's actually a maintained collection from a deacon's perspective, and that therefore this stuff is interesting. If it was interesting to him, it should be interesting to us. We just got to find out where the interest, or I took it on to try and find out where the interest sort of lies. Another example here, you can see the photograph on the right hand side on the floor. I don't know if it goes closer. Is that in Bacon studies, which is a heated area, which you, and a dangerous one to kind of like try and get into, I was lucky to get into it in a sort of like an obsessive way and get close to the people interested in it. One of the things that they're interested in is when Deakin started photographing his circle, and at which point Bacon became interested in these photographs that Deakin was taking. And this painting is a direct kind of like a correlation to this photograph. And the photograph was previously supposed to be around 63, 64, but because we have the negatives, and because I had the time and the inclination, I was able to kind of get close to that newspaper and by zooming in and finding a headline that was a picture of a horse running. It's a shame I haven't got a zoom. A picture of a horse running in profile, kind of that classic with virtually all four legs off the ground, and something biggest prize ever. So just by spending some time thinking about what kind of thing would be on the front page of the Evening Standard, and thinking that was probably the Grand National, and then talking to other people about, was there any other horse race that was ever on the front page, or is, you know, is it big enough news to get to a headline from 1958. Apparently the Grand National did have the biggest ever prize that it had ever had, and it was on the front page of newspapers. And so going to the National Archive, the British Library, trying to find a copy, and being disappointed because, of course, the Evening Standard had four editions a day, and they only ever kept one. And so I was thwarted in finally conclusively proving that this was 1958, but I still went around telling everybody that that's 1958, and managed to kind of shift the conversation much earlier to Deakin's involvement in photographing images that Bacon painted from. So there we are, there's Freud on the bed. So I've the image.